This episode is brought to you by Kia's first three-row, all-electric SUV, the Kia EV9. With available all-wheel drive and seating for up to 7 adults, with a 0-60 speed that thrills you 1 minute, and available reclining lounge seats that unwind you the next. Visit kia.com/EV9 to learn more. Ask your Kia dealer for availability. No system, no matter how advanced, can compensate for all driver error and or driving conditions. Always drive safely.
Join me, 48 Hours correspondent Erin Moriarty, on my podcast, My Life of Crime, as I take on true crime investigations like no other. This season, I'm looking into the labyrinth of crime and secrets within families. I'm cutting straight to the evidence and talking to the people directly involved, including investigators and the families of victims. Listen to My Life of Crime with Erin Moriarty wherever you get your podcasts.
This episode is brought to you by Klaviyo, the platform that powers smarter digital relationships. With Klaviyo, you can activate all your customer data in real time, connect seamlessly with your customers across all channels, guide your marketing strategy with AI-powered insights, recommendations, and automated assistance, deliver experiences that feel individually designed at scale, and grow your business faster. Power smarter digital relationships with Klaviyo. Learn more at klaviyo.com/Spotify. That's klaviyo.com/Spotify.
Ready to ride?
I thought you'd never ask.
Now streaming on Paramount Plus, it's the new original series, Lawmen, Bass Reeves.
Bass dedicated to justice.
From executive producer Taylor Sheridan, co-creator of Yellowstone, starring executive producer and Emmy Award nominated actor David Oyelowo, it's the untold story.
I'm warning you.
Of the greatest American lawman.
Your wicked days are done.
Lawmen, Bass Reeves, new original series, now streaming exclusively on Paramount Plus.
This episode is brought to you by Intercom. Their customer service AI? Intercom's customer service AI. Intercom's AI for customer service is years ahead of the competition. That means you get the lowest support volume, the fastest resolutions, the most efficient support team, and the world's happiest customers. Intercom, the leader in AI for customer service. Learn more at intercom.com.
When's the last time you got a letter? Like a handwritten letter?
I believe it was the guy who wrote to the Levitard show who was complaining about me. That's the closest thing I've gotten to a letter written.
Okay. What would you do if you got a letter of just someone wanting to catch up?
I'd probably text them, say, hey, got your letter. Like just a subtle demonstration of the power that we hold
in
our pockets.
Okay. Maze?
I mean, my mom writes letters a lot. But I wouldn't count that. I used to write letters to my one friend in Boston, but I fell off on that a couple years ago. So it's probably been a couple years.
Okay.
It's fun, though. I like writing a letter. I like
it's fun
not knowing what you wrote, right? So it's a nice little time capsule because once you send it, it's gone. You can't go look at it again. So.
Oh, that's actually interesting. The idea that you don't know what you wrote because like this would be like a mean... podcasting.
Yeah, Mean lives his life a quarter mile at a time.
Yeah, he doesn't remember anything he said on any podcast. I would say I remember about half the stuff I say. But every once in a while, you know, someone will be like, oh, you said this on a pod. I'm like, did I? That doesn't sound like something I'd say.
So the backdrop to this, because I've been listening to a lot of old Cinephobe episodes, and I told the guys, the funniest thing that happens is when I'm listening to an episode about a movie I don't remember. I mean, obviously I remember the movie, but I don't remember the details. And we're going through a scenario and Zach or Maze will say something. And in my head, I'll react a certain way. And then on the pod, I react literally the exact same way. Same joke, same framing, everything. It's pretty incredible.
Consistency.
It's what we call deja vu.
Isn't that a Denzel movie?
Yes, it is.
Does that qualify?
I think it might.
Deja Vu does not qualify, by the way.
Oh, that's a shame.
Too good.
Too good of a movie. Too good of a movie, unlike Money Plane.
What?
Come on, man. Don't do this.
Your picks have been horrible, man.
It's the point. It's the point of the show.
Isn't it?
Isn't it? I don't understand what this podcast is about.
Poppycock.
It's a fuck house.
On a weekly basis, we are consuming more concentrated bad movies than probably anybody in the history of mankind.
Poppycock.
What story? What story?
What are you talking about?
Do you want lunch?
I have yet to laugh in this movie. I'll just tell you that.
You picked it, motherfucker. Just remember that.
You know what the problem with Hollywood is? They make shit. Unbelievable, unremarkable shit.
I was legitimately offended.
You were offended?
I was offended.
I didn't know you could get offended.
I was offended.
This did it.
If I were gay, I wouldn't be offended.
They're fucking making shit up, I mean.
Inconsequential detail after inconsequential detail after inconsequential detail.
Bees don't lie.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. I'm holding a mic in my hands and now I'm talking all over. Okay.
Welcome to Cinephobe, the podcast where we break down the movies you're afraid to admit you love. I'm Zach Harper, that's Amin Alhassan, that's Anthony Mays. If you have a submission to submit, a reminder that it needs to be 40% or lower on Rotten Tomatoes for the audience or the critic's score. This week on Cinephobe, we watched the 2020 action movie, Money Plane.
I like how there's no other part of this.
That's all it said. It's just said an action movie.
Mays, what you got? What does your category say?
Yeah, back-to-back action. Money Train, Money Plane, action, action.
No heist.
I mean, there was a heist, but...
Right, but it's sort of... I mean, sort of a heist, right? I don't actually understand what happened at the end. We'll get into it. Money Plane stars Kelsey Grammer, Adam Copeland, and Thomas Jane.
Adam Copeland, also known as The Edge. Or Edge.
I don't know who Adam Copeland is. I don't know who The Edge is. I know who Thomas Jane is, but I don't know what character he played.
Thomas Jane was the friend. The buddy who's like the
oh my god,
godfather.
He's an old man now.
Yeah, man. He.
Oh no.
I got a note later on, but he wears the fuck out of some gray stubble.
I gotta clarify that it's Edge, not The Edge, the guitarist from U2.
Right, it's the wrestler,
and he's also in Vikings, which I've never watched.
Never seen it.
Tried. It was boring.
Kelsey Grammer, the Grand Marshal, plays the Rumble.
6-time Emmy Award winner Kelsey Grammer.
My favorite thing about Kelsey Grammer. Is every time I hear his name, I think of the outtakes from Rush Hour, where Chris Tucker is on the phone with the kidnappers, and they say, you got to deliver like $10 million. And he said, $10 million? Damn, what you got, Kelsey Clinton? He tries to say Chelsea Clinton, and he keeps saying, Kelsey Clinton. He says, Kelsey Grammer, Chelsea Grammer. He just can't remember the name Chelsea Clinton. And every time I hear Kelsey Grammer, I always think of that. The last one he said, what do you got, Kelsey Grammer?
Kelsey Grammer has like a top five voice for me.
It is a good voice.
Sancho Bob.
Well, yeah, but I'm just talking about in this movie, when he's talking, oh my God, that dude's got a voice.
No, okay. Part of it is that.
I would love to have his pipes.
He's got a voice. He definitely has a voice. But there's another part of it where he's literally the only actor here.
He is the only actor in this movie.
It pops off the screen.
Right.
Whenever he's on, they're like, oh, that's what acting looks like.
There are notes where I say, I don't know if he's acting his ass off or he's just alone. All right. Kelsey was coming off Future Cinephobe Grand Isle in 2019. And he has something called The God Committee coming out in 2021.
Oh, God.
You may also remember him from playing Bonaparte in Expendables 3. Adam Copeland was the wrestler called Edge. He was in a movie called Interrogation in 2016. He was also in WrestleMania 36 in 2020. Thomas Jane was in the Buffy the Vampire Slayer movie in 1992 and The Punisher in 2004. Also a Deep Blue Seaman.
He did Face Off and Boogie Nights back-to-back in 97, 98. It's pretty sick. Boogie Nights I just watched and he comes in. He's basically Todd, the stripper who has all the drugs.
Thomas Jane. I always think about two things. One, didn't he play Mickey Mantle?
Yeah, Mickey Mantle in 61 asterisk. Barry Pepper was Roger Maris. Great movie.
But also the Thomas Jane and Guy Pearce. I always used to get them confused.
Such a racist.
Wasn't he the vampire in True Blood?
Was he in True Blood?
No.
He's not Bill?
We just all look alike?
No.
Okay, never mind then.
You just compared Thomas Jane to an Australian and an English actor.
Okay. They all look alike.
All right. We're also getting Denise Richards from Starship Troopers, Wild Things, and The Real Housewives of Beverly Hills.
And Undercover Brother.
Oh, that's right.
White She-Devil. That's how I know her.
And future Cinephobe, Tammy and the T-Rex. Mark that one down, guys.
We also get the Lawrence brothers, Joey from Blossom, Matthew from Mrs. Doubtfire, and Andy from, well, we got Joey and Matthew Lawrence in this one.
Joey Lawrence was the dude on the ground, right? Iggy.
No, Joey's the concierge.
Iggy is Andrew, and Matthew was Crockett. So I remember them from a show called Brotherly Love on the Disney Channel.
Oh.
That must have just been in a sweet spot when I was like at my grandma's house for 2 weeks every summer just watching a shitload of Disney Channel. Because I think I probably watched 20 episodes of that show.
I mean, the sweet spot was Zach and 24.
Cody? You guys want to try your jokes again or you just want me to edit it so that you say them sequentially?
Yeah. No, I kind of like them jumbled together.
I kind of want you to edit it.
I mean, Maze was 24.
The sweet spot was Zach and Cody.
By the way, Money Plane, directed by Andrew Lawrence.
He's a real Renaissance man, that third Lawrence brother.
He also directed something called The Office Mix-Up, which starred Joey and Matthew Lawrence. He also directed a TV movie called Killer Competition about a valedictorian investigated for killing a top student. He also wrote the screenplay for Money Plane. It's his only writing credit, as did Tim Schafe, who also gets a screenplay credit. His only other writing credit is called Better Than Love, which stars Matthew and Andy Lawrence.
It's a family affair.
We get story credits from Tyler W. Connie, who wrote a movie called Blackwater with Van Damme and Dolph Lundgren.
Oh, wow. Does that qualify?
I'm sure it does. I think every single credit of these guys is Cinephobe territory.
0% qualifies.
Safe bet.
Also, Richard Switzer has a story credit. He also wrote Blackwater. Synopsis for Money Plane. A professional thief with $40 million in debt and his family's life on the line must commit one final heist, rob a futuristic airborne casino filled with the world's most dangerous criminals.
So futuristic.
Tagline. An explosive casino heist in the sky.
Yeah. That's not a tagline. That's a synopsis.
Also a much more succinct synopsis. Couldn't get any budget estimations, what it grossed, what it made.
Yeah, nothing.
Nothing. Nothing at all.
The only other movies we have that don't have any info are the Netflix movies.
Right.
Every single other movie we have, there's a budget out there and there's a gross. Even Theodore Rex.
I can tell you, the budget could not have been high and it was gross.
Well done. One of the things that I really enjoyed about this movie was any scene where he's in the cockpit. I literally just sat and laughed at the background.
The fight in the cockpit killed me.
That and how he jumped off the plane.
All right. If you want to watch the movie before we get into it, Money Plane is available on Hulu. Money Plane receives 25% from critics on 12 reviews on Rotten Tomatoes, 40% from the audience on 48 ratings.
Wow, it's gone up.
This is literally the lowest watched rated thing we've ever tackled.
Whenever I wrote this down, it was 22 and 29. So it's climbing, guys.
Wow.
Wow. I was under the impression that this movie was a Netflix movie.
No.
And it wasn't. But it was direct streaming, right? It didn't.
I think the plan was to be released. But I don't know what happened. Maybe someone watched it before they were going to put it in theaters. Mean, do you want the positive or the negative reviews?
I'm a glass half full kind of guy, Zach. So give me the positives.
Well, everybody's just thinking about the negative. Well, I think the glass is half full. Everybody thinks it's half empty.
Steven Silver of Splice Today. It isn't good, exactly, and it's notably cheap looking. But I still had a smile on my face for large parts of it.
Accurate.
I mean, same.
I mean, I guess.
EJ Moreno of Flickering Myth. This feels like a throwback to the best cheesy 90s action movies. Sometimes all your movie needs to be is pure dumb, and Money Plane is exactly that.
Pure uncut dumb.
Alan Ang of Film Threat.
Film Threat or Film Thread?
Film Threat.
Wow, okay. Aggressive.
The espionage and science are implausible at best, but were you really expecting a realistic plot?
I mean, kind of.
More than this. All right, we got some user reviews because we literally had three positive reviews from the critics. User Rick W., 5 out of 5 stars. I love it when a film doesn't take itself too seriously. Perfect tone and a great escape from current events.
The current events they're talking about is the coronavirus pandemic.
See, now I was thinking maybe Black Lives Matter.
Oh, wow.
I was thinking maybe this one got left in like April or May.
Oh, man.
User Stephen L., 5 out of 5 stars. Look, it isn't going to win any awards, maybe a Razzie, but this movie isn't trying to do that. It was a fun ride that had me smiling and cheering throughout the experience. Crack open a beer and sit back, relax, and enjoy.
Speaking of which.
User Mark J., 4 out of 5 stars. I liked it. I found it entertaining. I like the concept of pulling a heist on a plane while in flight. And then user Chris Y., 5 out of 5 stars. I'm the goddamn Money Plane.
What?
I don't know.
I was going to say, oh, he's quoting. And I'm like, no, that wasn't.
The fuck?
All right, time for the negative reviews.
At this point of time, my thought on critics not liking stuff is, then turn it off, you fucking weirdo. You have so many options. People who watch an entire project to hate on it, man, it is so weird to me.
Sean Burns of North Shore Reviews. This is no smarmy meta exercise in self-mockery, but rather a feat of genuine incompetence. It comes by its crappiness, honestly. Josh Bell of Crooked Marquee. The heist plan makes no sense. The action is sporadic and listless. The dialogue is full of macho nonsense, and the set where most of the movie was shot only vaguely resembles the interior of a plane.
Yeah, I went back and forth on that. We'll have to come back to that later.
Yeah, I got a lot of notes on that.
You know what's funny is usually in the movies, they'll say this thing is set as the inside of an apartment or inside of a plane or something like that. And you'll look at it and they'll show a picture from the outside. And like, no way. This place is huge on the inside and the outside looks tiny. This is one of the few times I can remember it was the opposite, where the picture of the plane from the outside was like a jumbo 757.
Yeah.
But on the inside is like the size of a PJ.
Or the size of maybe a studio apartment where it was filmed. Jeffrey M. Anderson of Common Sense Media. Almost a guilty pleasure, this heist movie benefits a bit from an I don't care attitude. But unfortunately, it's crushed under too many dumb cliches, terrible writing, and general boredom.
General boredom.
Reporting for duty, sir.
Peter Subzinski of efilmcritic.com. Look, I do not object to the fact that Money Plane is trying to be the most self-consciously dopey movie of recent memory. What I object to is that the whole thing is too stupid and lazy to accomplish even that not exactly lofty goal. Mark Dusik?
Mark Dusik.
D-U-J-S-I-K.
That's Dusik for me.
Mark Dusik of Mark Reviews Movies.
I bet he does.
It's not Dusik Reviews Movies.
He's got a different website for that.
The filmmakers have made a laughable movie and didn't think to laugh at themselves.
I think they did.
Your boy, Brian Orndorff of Blu-ray.com.
Wow, a negative review from him?
And only one this time. Usually he double dips. Money Plane doesn't deliver when it counts the most, but there's an idea here that holds potential, gifting the endeavor an entertaining dark side. He tries so hard.
What?
He tries so hard.
I hate him so much, man. Him and what's the other guy?
Caffeinated Clint?
Caffeinated Clint. Fuck that guy. Is he here today?
No, he's not. I wish Wally Waffles was. I miss him. Nick Shager of The Daily Beast. In the history of dumb ideas, few have been stupider than the Money Plane. Ian Thomas Malone of Ian Thomas Malone.
Wait, hold on. Is this a user review or?
No, this is in the critics review.
He just got a website named after himself.
That's what it said. Money Plane could have been a fun disaster of a film, but Copeland's obvious boredom sucks all the air out of the cockpit. Travis Hobson of Punch Drunk Critics. There are rare moments when Money Plane is as over the top as we'd like it to be, but the premise is never capitalized on as it should be. I got three user reviews. User, and there was no name given, 1 out of 5 stars. Aside from one ridiculous monologue from Kelsey Grammer in the beginning, and the comforting presence of a grizzled Thomas Jane in a small role, this cheapo heist movie is embarrassingly awful. To prove my point, its star, a known wrestler, spends most of the heist, flying the plane. Why?
Did Mike Ryan write that review?
It sounded a lot like
because
Mike
that
Ryan's
was the
review.
Exact same criticism he had for the movie.
I was dying when he texted that. User Catherine W. gave 1 out of 5 stars. Well, we are 10 minutes in, not sure how we lasted this long, and we are done. My husband, who can watch anything, is going to give it another 5 minutes and call it quits. Bad lighting and curtains make up most of the quote-unquote sets. Kelsey Grammer's few minutes gave me hope, but alas, we are now on the money plane, and I fear nothing is going to improve. Words that come to mind, cliche, lackluster, oh, and embarrassing. Suddenly, my $5.99 rental fee seems a regrettable investment.
Jesus Christ.
Yep, my husband just hit the wall. We're out.
Jesus, they paid.
I like that the idea that she's typing that like 9 minutes into the movie.
Real time.
Yeah. And then last one, user Donald P. gave it 0.5 star out of 5 stars. Is this movie supposed to be this bad? Is it supposed to be a comedy? The trailer had 10 times the production value than all of the rest of the movie. Someone made a very bad bet on this movie. I agree. The trailer fucking bangs.
That user, you know, he's...
what's coming here?
This is quite the... That user, he's actually a pretty famous actor. He stars in La Pulitura in Italy. That's the Italian version of Scrubs. His name is Donald Faison.
Were you stalling to Google Scrubs in Italian?
That was such a long walk to nowhere.
Paisa!
Welcome to Cinephobe!
I'm getting bored. Why don't we just skip to the end?
Amin, what's your first note?
My first note, because I didn't know anything about this movie. I knew Kelsey Grammer was in it. I remember when it came out, I thought it was a Netflix movie starring Kelsey Grammer, so I thought it was going to be like, oh, you know, like cheap action movie. Like any one of these action movies that come out that are, you know, of a certain quality. And so I'm watching it and I'm recognizing everything looks so low budget, including the actors and the roles they're playing. And so I ask, am I watching the right movie? And moments after that, the subtitles say suspenseful music. They misspelled suspenseful.
Suspenseful?
S-U-S-P-E-N-F-U-L. Suspenseful. Like it's full of these writing instruments that we're not quite sure of. Suspenseful. I was really confused, and I said, these actors all look very B-movie. So those were my first three notes, because I legit was confused if I had picked the right movie. Maybe there was another money plane out there.
We open up with Edge saying, I learned early on in my career that a job well done has three critical parts. My next note, was this thing shot in a dentist's office?
See, there you go.
Edge looks awkwardly dressed. They made a point to show us that he wears glasses for some reason. And his security card won't swipe for these guards.
The guards who are all awful casting jobs.
Awful.
They literally just grab people walking down the street.
They just like, oh, that guy's kind of big.
But he's not. He's just fat.
He's supposed to be at a museum of fine art.
That took me a while to know that they were at a museum.
Well, it certainly doesn't look like one.
He says, first, the right crew. It takes more than one flint to make a fire. Which I don't think is actually true.
Yeah, you need one flint and you need kindling.
When he took his glasses off, I wrote, acting his ass off.
Way too early for that.
I know.
We got a hacker helping him get the card right, and he gets through the metal detector in the dentist's office. He says, two, there's how things are and how they appear to be. We find out the machine guns for the guards are new within the last 2 days. Edge says it feels off, but stay the course. Also, he doesn't know his right from his left, which I didn't think was acting.
Yeah, other left.
Walks into a room and is looking for a painting of some sort, but this hacker can't see him in the room, and he sees the painting. The painting isn't actually there, though, and we've got a speed-looped video situation. They put a device on the hacker's van. He says to abort the mission. We've been compromised. He's now locked in the room and a gas canister goes off outside of it. And then he says, three, plan A is only as good as your plan B.
Okay, can we stop right here? These are not the three critical parts of a job.
I wrote, these are horrible rules to getting a job done.
I like the way Mace said it better. Because he said, these are not the three elements. And as if he has three elements at the ready.
Yeah, Mace, do you have three elements?
I got the fifth element right here.
Some woman in a leather jacket breaks open the door. Guards are knocked out on the floor everywhere.
Yeah, they do that classic thing of we hear sound effects of punches, but then we don't see the fight.
My next note, wait a second. They got outside. They've all got guns. There is no barrier between the guards and these two people. And they're shooting at each other from what is roughly 7 feet away. And nobody gets hit. Are blood capsules that expensive?
As the movie goes on, you'll find an answer to that question, Zach. Yes. Yes, they are.
Andrew Lawrence drives them away. And next we cut to Kelsey Grammer, who is smoking the fuck out of a cigar.
Darius Emmanuel Grouch, the third. Better known as the Rumble.
But hold on, your last name is Grouch. Why would you have a nickname?
Because it's the Rumble.
I thought he was going to say better known as Oscar.
And when he says the Rumble, there's a caption that says light thunder rumbling sound effect.
Oh, yeah. They definitely described every sound that was happening.
I wrote, did he just exposition himself?
Oh.
There's a lot of that. There's a lot of exposition.
Oh, there's a lot of that coming up. There's a scene. Like, I spent most of my time in my notes trying to find out the way to describe it. Officer exposition, doctor exposition, all the different expositions we've had throughout Cinephobe. But by the way, that would be nice, right? If we had like an intern who could do a montage of Cinephobe episodes with all the different exposition characters.
I'll shortcut it for you right now. I mean, this movie is made and starring the Exposition Brothers.
All three Lawrence brothers are exposition. That's all they are.
I am very disappointed. The painting wasn't there. Someone knew we were coming. Warhol, de Kooning, Pollock. Bunch of bitches.
A henchman behind him holds up a white canvas behind the edge.
How about I just blow your brains out? I'll create my own damn Pollock.
Was this the henchman's job just to get a prop for this moment?
Man, there's a lot of weird jobs in this movie. Let me just say.
What else does he have ready? Like, is he the carrot top of henchmen? He just got a trunk over there in the atrium that's like.
Rodrigo. get the blank canvas when this guy comes in. Yes, boss.
You a gambling man, Jack?
Not anymore.
Once a gambling man, always a gambling man. You bet everything you had. You had a 50-50 shot, Jack. Toss up a coin. One side. In a split second, you make enough money to retire. You, your crew, your family, live the life they always dreamed of. On the other side, you lose. Everything. My, how everything can change in just a second. You trusted your gut, Jack. And it lied to you.
I've paid for it ever since.
I can see Edge reading off of cue cards.
Why are you calling Kelsey Grammer the Rumble, by the way?
Are you kidding me?
Are you kidding me?
What the fuck am I supposed to call him?
I call him Kelsey.
No, he's the Rumble. I mean, really, he's Darius Emmanuel Grouch III, but I'm calling him the Rumble.
It took me a second to realize that he was referring to himself, because I thought for a second he was talking to Edge. But no. That's how he starts the conversation. This is my full name.
Part of the problem with this movie is everyone met an hour before they filmed their scenes. There's no chemistry at all in this movie. Absolutely none.
I'm shocked that you would give them that sort of consideration, the idea that these people they pulled off the street to be in the movie had been there for an hour before they started shooting.
I like that you caught yourself from calling them actors.
These are not actors.
One's a wrestler who flies a plane.
No, I'm not even talking about that guy, because at least he knew he was going to be in this. I'm talking about everybody else in this movie who looked like they were just asked to do this. And it's, okay. Like, they had no intention of acting that day. When they woke up in the morning.
The Rumble bought the Edge's debt because he's an opportunist. He saved Edge. He wants his damn painting. It was a $40 million painting. And Edge says, can we just get to the job? And I wrote, I was thinking the same thing. we just move this along.
I'm tired of the exposition, says the Edge.
7 minutes in, I wrote, this is the worst movie we've ever done.
No, look, hey, man, I went back and I listened to Jupiter Ascending and Theodore Rex. And let me just say, Cats might, we probably might have crowned Cats a little too quick.
Jupiter Ascending at least had, like,
you want to crown them, then crown
money
them.
Behind it.
The Bears are who we thought they were. And that's why we took the damn field. Now, if you want to crown them, then crown their ass. But they are who we thought they were. And we let them off the hook.
I can't believe you were already at this point with Money playing in this scene, because I was just so excited to see Kelsey Grammer, and he's really chewing this,
well, hold on,
quote-unquote dialogue.
Hold on.
He turns it around right here, right?
His next scene, or his next line is,
there is a legend in the underworld, those in the know, it's called a money plane.
He said it.
Some of the baddest motherfuckers on the planet are on that plane, all craving action. Whatever you want to wager on, the money plane has you covered. You want to bet on a dude fucking an alligator. Money plane.
Really set my expectations too high on that.
My next note, I have until the end of the segment to take a take back, right?
So here's my question. If you had to come up with one scenario, you want to see a blank, 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 money plane, what would it be?
If you want to bet on watching a chimpanzee perform open heart surgery, money plane.
You want to see Sophia Loren use a hedgehog as a loofah, money plane.
You want to see men become boys and boys become men, money plane.
Wow.
Wow.
Is that kid touching?
Is that the first time Maze has actively leaned into it?
By the way, I posted that clip on Twitter. Matt Grahovec tweeted me, Kelsey Grammer, ... acting his ass off.
Let me tell you something. Kelsey Grammer, first of all, my note is Kelsey is acting his ass off. There's only one other guy who's fighting Kelsey Grammer for the Golden Dumpster, as far as I'm concerned. And it is a fucking knockdown, drag out, game seven overtime battle.
I think I know.
I don't think you do.
Untouchable by any government because the flight always takes place in international airspace. I wrote, I don't think that's a thing.
Definitely not.
There are very much fighter jets that will come gun you out of the sky everywhere. The Rumble will get him and his crew on the plane with backstories. Now the props henchman opens up a laptop. We get a pic of Denise Richards, some kid, and a dog. If he doesn't get him what he wants from the money plane, he won't have anything to come back to. Kelsey Grammer, acting his ass off, or just alone. Gives him a duffel bag with everything he'll need, have a safe flight. And the Rumble's so pleased with himself after he says, have a safe flight.
One last job.
And then next, we get opening credits. I wrote, wait, that was a cold open?
That's insane, but I love it.
You know how bad it's got to be for us to be like, yo, that's a long-ass cold open?
Right.
I mean, that's next level right there. As I'm watching the opening credits, I'm beginning to realize this is the movie. And it is extremely, extremely cheap. And I wrote, this makes Sharknado look like Schindler's List.
Schindler's got a list. I don't.
Attaway, Bobby!
If they don't give us an alligator on board at some point, I'll be very upset.
That's what I'm saying!
Spoiler alert.
There is no alligator.
It's not a future callback. It's fucked up. Like, that could have been the trailer by itself.
Yeah. Oh my god, yeah. Absolutely. The crew's in some empty warehouse floor, standing over a crate. And I wrote, Andy Lawrence is a triple threat. He will ruin your movie with directing, acting, and writing. He doesn't deliver anything.
Yo, that is the truest definition of triple threat.
Yeah.
He's a threat to your picture.
Mac Weldon will be the most comfortable underwear, socks, shirts, undershirts, hoodies, and sweatpants, and more that you will ever wear. They have a line of silver underwear and shirts that are naturally antimicrobial, which means they eliminate odor. They want you to be comfortable, so if you don't like your first pair of underwear, you can keep it and they will still refund you, no questions asked. Not only does Mack Weldon's underwear, socks, and shirts look good, they perform well too. It's good for working out, going to work, going out on dates, just everyday life. Mack Weldon really does value its loyal customers, that's why they've created the Weldon Blue Loyalty Program. Here's how it works. Create an account. It's totally free. Level 1, place an order for any amount and never pay for shipping again. Level 2, once you purchase $200 worth of products from Mack Weldon, not only will you continue to receive free shipping, but you will also start saving 20% on every order you make for the next year. Level 2 also grants you access to new products before they're released to anyone else, as well as free gifts added to future orders. I have some Mack Weldon socks, Mack Weldon underwear, and I'm wearing my Mack Weldon sweatpants right now. It's fantastic. I wear it all the time. It's a quarantine. You never leave the house. You gotta have Mack Weldon sweats. For 20% off your first order, visit MackWeldon.com and enter promo code DING. That's promo code DING, D-I-N-G.
Edge tells him they're robbing the money plane. It has $1 billion in crypto. Andy loves it. Edge will be Mr. Monroe, a digital human trafficker that Isabella killed in Moscow last year.
There's a flashback to that scene, which is Isabella riding up to a parked car in a parking lot and shooting a dude in the face.
I didn't know if this guy's name was Trey or Dre, and I never cared to look it up. But the black guy...
Trey.
Okay. He'll be the right-hand man on the plane. Isabella will be a flight attendant. Andy Lawrence will be his main man on the ground.
Yeah, clearly no one gave Andrew Lawrence notes on delivery because he's the director.
As soon as I saw this scene, I asked, is this everyone's first movie? I already don't like this Iggy guy. Just everything about him, I was like, this dude is a fucking prick. Not the character, the person playing him.
I wrote... Him being his main man on the ground had big, hey, bucko, I need you to be dad's special helper today and hold the ruler energy.
Yeah, it was super weird for him to give himself that part.
But also, like, I think he needed a part where he wasn't doing a whole lot.
I guess.
Andy's pissed. The plan is for Edge to take over flying the plane while Isabella searches the vault.
Yeah, they have this basically visualization of their plan going perfectly.
And the sets, I mean, like, it is...
They walk right into the cockpit, right into the vault, right into the server room. No resistance. They'll parachute out. No one will notice they were there.
Edge and his daughter are pillow fighting. Denise Richards sends her to bed. Zero tension here.
She still can't act her way out of a paper bag after all these years.
I mean, she looks like fucking Meryl Streep next to this dude.
Yo, let me tell you something. First of all, Jesus, Denise Richards. Not only her face, her voice.
She was dating Charlie Sheen for a long time.
Oh, my God. What was she eating? Is she eating raw cocaine?
Tiger blood. I think she looks great, considering she was with Charlie Sheen for as long as she was.
Oh, man. White she-devil. He fallen upon hard times.
Edge and his child have the chemistry of two strangers 40 years apart who just met.
He's reading her Robin Hood for some heavy moral exposition. So, it's okay to steal if it's someone bad?
Mace, I called it. Bedtime exposition. Daddy, will you read me a bedtime exposition?
This kid just falls directly asleep when the mom walks in.
Lights are on, everything.
She just finished a sentence. Mom walks in, kid's asleep. Like fucking narcolepsy.
Future callback on the Robin Hood, by the way.
Edge is having a weird dream about the Rumble.
He's thinking about what the Rumble said earlier, like verbatim, except it's different footage of Kelsey Grammer, but he's still smoking a cigar, except he's inside now.
No, he's smoking the fuck out of that cigar.
Smoking his ass off.
He's going to town on that cigar.
Kelsey Grammer's cigars probably were like a third of the budget.
He probably had to bring his own. They probably like bought him a Black and Mild. He's like, no, I'll just go grab my own. Yeah, he's having a weird dream. He can't sleep. He sees headlights sweep by the place. He pulls a gun out of the dresser. We see him with his shirt off so he can show off the abs. Then Thomas Jane was sneaking in. They're all good now. And he says, remind me again, why did you make me your daughter's godfather? And I wrote, Thomas, the exposition tank engine.
Godfather exposition.
I like Thomas, the exposition. I like that. That's good.
Wrote the note, he's wearing the fuck out of some gray stubble. He looks old, but man, I think it's working for him.
I love Thomas Jane.
All right, he's smoking a pipe in the backyard. Mm-hmm. Which I liked.
Not weed, right? Like, that's just a weird little plastic tobacco pipe.
I think it's just tobacco. Like, fucking, you know, the wizard from Lord of the Rings. Edge was one of the best poker players back in the day. Then he got greedy, and him losing was the best thing that ever happened to him.
I'll tell you what he's stuffing in that pipe. Raw exposition.
By the way, when Edge gets up from his bad dream, he reaches for a gun that's just in the drawer. I said, no child safety in this household.
None.
Like, it's just right there.
Had the same thought. Thomas Jane says that he has great instincts. By the way, we never see these poker instincts ever again. He loses. He loses. He loses to a drunk cowboy.
You were the best. One of the best. What a downgrade.
He won't come with the Edge this time. And I wrote, he's basically trying to set up Money Plane 2, letting them know he'll do more if he's paid more.
It felt like Thomas Jane was just like, I feel like they tried to put him on the crew and on the plane. He's like, I'm not doing all that. You got 4 hours to shoot my scenes. That's it.
Not this time, buddy. I got this thing about planes. Heh, coming from the youngest major general in the United States Air Force. Hell, I would have made lieutenant if I didn't quit to run around the world with you.
He's going to look into the museum job that went wrong. And I wrote, that was supposed to be a museum?
Something seems off about that.
That's what I found out. The dentist's office was a museum.
He says if anything goes wrong, he's a phone call away. How would he do anything on the money plane if he got called?
I don't know. Also, they cut to the terminal with the money plane. It says money plane terminal, undisclosed location. I wrote, but then how did they get there?
First of all, second of all, undisclosed location, that's a full-on airport. That's not an airstrip.
You can't hide that.
That's a full-on airport with TSA and, like, shops and duty-free.
Right.
I mean, it is an airport. It has an aerial shot of an airport. Long Beach is more subtle and indescript than this thing.
We find out Trey's name, his identity for this is going to be Mr. McGillicuddy.
They're checking in to the plane in what looks like backstage at a high school play.
Yes. Yes, it does.
And they store all the guns in a bucket.
In a bucket.
It looks like SNL.
It does, yeah.
Right? It looks like an SNL sketch. Like just the set and you know how they just walk up and yes, just drop it in the bucket. We'll figure out who owns what later.
It looks like an SNL sketch, but cheaper.
Yes.
When I found out that Trey's name is Mr. McGillicuddy, I said, will he get found out who he really is? You never know.
I see what you did there.
Yeah.
I was annoyed that I had to type McGillicuddy a bunch of times after this.
When he said McGillicuddy, I legit, now I'm at a place in life where when people in popular culture, in movies, well, I shouldn't call this popular culture because I don't think it was popular, but in movies, well, and I shouldn't call it culture either because it definitely wasn't culture.
So what are you left movie, with?
Yeah, what are we left with? What do we call this?
In movies and, you know, songs or whatever, when they make references to something that is, I mean, McGillicuddy, that's a very Levitard show reference, right?
Right.
Is it beyond the pale to imagine that whoever wrote this?
That Andy Lawrence listens to Levitard?
I mean, look, Daniel Baldwin does.
I think all he listens to is cocaine.
So you guys have experience in reaching lower tier brothers.
Daniel Baldwin does sports radio in like Buffalo.
Syracuse.
That's why he knows. That's why he knows of Levitard. Andy Lawrence does cocaine in Joey Lawrence's guest house and works on his screenplays. Okay? I think there's a difference here than Daniel Baldwin and Andy Lawrence. But Roy, see if you can get Andy Lawrence on the Levitard show.
Or whatever that show is called now.
Oh yeah, whatever that's going to be. Save that for when you guys go to fill in option here. They have digital wallet wristbands. And I wrote, it's a lot like Firefest. And then I asked the question, would you guys go if they had a Firefest 2? I think I would at this point. I think I'd trust it.
You know, they would have learned from so many of their mistakes.
Yeah, they can't get it wrong like this twice. Right?
What, you think Firefest could not Firefest it twice?
Firefest in the sky?
Too fire, too fest? What do we think?
All right. Keep going.
This dude in the mustache just said, nice. Really nice.
Yeah, there's a bunch of weird looking people on this plane. And that's when I start thinking that it really doesn't look that big.
Right.
And Joey Lawrence is the concierge. But when he introduces himself, he says, concierge.
Yeah, he's never actually said that word.
Yeah, he's never said that word before.
He's never said that word in his life.
I can't stress enough how low rent the set is for the fake plane. Like the budget could not have been more than like $800 for set design.
You know, I went back and forth the whole time. Apparently that is a plane.
No, fuck out of here. That's a plane.
You know, no. We can get to this later, I guess.
Absolutely not.
Are you telling us something that you found from Research Maze or are you just guessing?
The trivia, they said they got a plane. That's all I say. It doesn't look like it.
No, they fucking lied. They lied.
Crop duster.
That is an apartment in Burbank.
In Van Nuys. Not even Burbank.
Reseda.
Burbank is too close to actual Hollywood.
All right. The mustache guy really wants Isabella.
Okay. All right.
This is the guy.
Hold on.
This is the guy that you're talking about. I mean, because Fat Baker Mayfield.
Hold on. Is it Ivan?
Vertelli?
I don't know. I just called him Fat Baker Mayfield the whole
time. Okay, hold on. Okay, there's a couple of things. So the first dude, Ivan... with the red sweater and the gold chain says,
I called him One Chains.
When he says,
can I give you a nice tip so we can be friends?
This dude has never gotten pussy in his life, right? And because he's the same dude who says, ah, what's up with the ratio? Where are the ladies? And so then Joey Lawrence says, don't worry. You know, the staff is a staff. You can't touch staff, but we have entertainment for you. And he claps his hands and the lights go purple and the girls come out. And I said, wait. Are these girls and the lights guy waiting for the cue to be a clap for them to come out and for the lights to change?
Yeah, clap on, clap off.
But then pretty short after, the lights are back.
Yes.
To normal.
Oh, the next cut.
And so this is the best part. So the girls come and sit in the lap saying, hey, God, with the bimbo talk in the movies that never happens in real life. And Ivan says,
Reed, this is amazing.
Holy shit.
And I wrote, please let that be his one line in the whole movie. I just wanted those to be his only words. Holy shit. Leave it at that.
The man who runs the house says there's zero tolerance for cheating on this flight.
Yeah, that guy's from The Sopranos. He's the bookkeeper.
He says no fighting, no murder, no dismemberment, unless it's part of an event.
There you go.
Plane takes off, and who I called One Chains, or the guy that means they've got no pussy, says, now that is a smooth takeoff. And I said, yeah, it's almost like they were in a studio apartment in Glendale and not some plane.
Again, Glendale is too close. You got to be at Alhambra at closest.
Lounge and sportsbook are introduced. It has cocaine. Then the casino floor has traditional casino fare, like a poker table and cocaine.
It's the exact same room, but with a poker table.
And then they have a guest room with a shower and bed.
We don't see it.
And cocaine.
And we don't see the shower or the bed. That's true.
Yeah. Also, I was trying to figure out, all right, this is clearly a shotgun layout because it's a plane. Where are these rooms?
You know, in the plane somewhere. In the aft. That's plane terminology.
The babes are not for sale, but the hookers come out, as you mentioned. Mustache loves it.
Concierge also breaks the fourth wall, looks right at us.
He does. Joey Lawrence looks right into the camera.
What did you call him, Maze?
The concierge?
Yeah, there you go. Thank you.
All right. Texas Hold'em is about to begin on the main casino floor.
No, it's not. Because what's about to begin is Texas Exposition. Holy shit, the exposition in this scene. In Well Done movies, each actor gets a folder about their character, their name, where they're from, their motivations. Everyone literally took turns reading each other's folder.
Yeah, they mixed up the folders.
So then they had to like, well, I don't know what my character does. All right.
I also love that Trey and Edge, they talk and they're like, I need to find the server room. I need to take control of the cockpit. So they walk right up to a poker table.
So we find out that the creepy dude is one of the biggest arms dealers. We get exposition on how he armed Iraq with nukes, but he was acquitted by the UN for something.
Sure.
The mustache grabs Isabella's arm. She'll kill him at some point, I wrote.
She says, can I get you a drink? And he says, I said, holy shit, guy gets a second line. Gin. And then he grabs her arm. And then I said, holy shit, guy gets a third line. You seem to like it. And then as she walks away and Edge tries to play Captain Save-A-Ho, despite being a human trafficker.
I actually like this.
Hold on. A gay guy comes up and asks him, well, can I get you to drink, sir? And holy shit, slaps the fuck out of him.
He hits him. The fuck out of him.
And the guy starts crying. It's wrong, but it's so funny.
It's so bad. It's just...
This scene is out of control.
Funny, man.
I don't know if he's gay, by the way. I should... an effeminate, man. I don't know if he's actually gay.
But the arms dealer has a point, I wrote.
Oh, I'm with you, Zach.
The human trafficker has an issue with Fat Baker Mayfield hitting on a flight attendant?
And he says if the trafficked humans had his guns, they wouldn't be forced into labor. Touché!
Yeah.
He's kind of an honest arms dealer.
Well, he sold his first weapon before he lost his virginity, Zach, so he's a tradesman.
That
could have been a week before filming. That's for all we know.
Yeah, for real. Such a weird exchange.
We get a dealing and betting montage with the poker game, and then I realize I was about to get mad at them for smoking on the flight, and then I realized they're in international airspace and anything goes. And then I wrote all of this just for some fucking poker.
Where is the alligator fucking?
That's what I'm saying.
Also, they didn't even get the dealing correct for Texas Hold'em.
At one point, the concierge comes by, says, quite the game, and the music changes. Tension.
Matthew Lawrence calls an all-in bet from Edge. He feels alive, and he wins the bet. And I wrote, he's kind of acting his ass off a little bit.
Howdy, folks!
Who is this Yosemite Sam ass motherfucker? This is the worst fake mustache ever.
It's terrible!
No, he's acting his ass off. The mustache is hanging on for dear life.
Mr. J.R. Crockett.
I put some, because I heard someone call him J.R. Crockett, and I said, haha, that's a funny, like, disrespectful way to call him. And then he identifies himself as J.R. Crockett, and I'm like, wait, this is serious?
That's not all, because Edge is going to a room to rest. McGillicuddy's going to get the funds and play for him. And then Matthew Lawrence says the line, well, you know I'm a Texan. And I wrote, this is the best exposition movie we've ever had.
Exposition!
Exposition planned. Exposition.
The music playing during the poker montage is amazing. And then the other part was the woman playing, she has the worst poker face ever. Ever, 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 ever.
Nah, 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 nah.
Fat Baker gets down to the hull of the plane where Isabella is.
Hey, honey.
You're not supposed to be down here.
Rules were meant to be fucked. You want to get fucked.
Real bounce back by holy shit guy.
She takes a drag off his cigarette, drops the cigarette, tells him to leave. He wants to know what's in the bag she's holding. There's a lot of close talking. I wrote, this dude's kind of acting his ass off. I'm in on his character. I think his character has the most depth out of anyone not Kelsey Grammer. Matthew Lawrence picks Russian roulette for the next event.
Yeah, because he said he wants vodka.
Yeah.
As a tease.
The house manager announces the game and introduces J.R. Crockett as the undefeated champion of Russian roulette. And I'm like, yeah, of course he is. He's alive. Of course he's undefeated.
He starts monologuing his ass off. I can't lose. I can't be beat.
I finally realized this is what I sound like when I boast to people how good I am at Casino War.
Yes, it is.
Like, that's what I'm like, oh, that's why people look at me like that.
And then I figured out that the concierge is Joey Lawrence. I did not know it was him this whole time.
The other part that struck me was when he said, you got balls of steel, amigo. And I just thought to myself, he talks like the scene in Horrible Bosses 2 when they're calling in the ransom.
The roughest, toughest, coarsest rope in our rope inventory.
That's exactly how he talks.
We got your boy.
That mixture between Sudeikis and Charlie Day.
Here.
Yeah, partner.
Charlie Day. They have to tell him to tone it back.
He says, like Southerner, not prospector.
Yo, you guys are going to laugh because in the future Patreon episode where we did all the Golden Dumpsters, when we get to Horrible Bosses 2, it's just you two going back and forth, giggling so hard you can't even say the lines from Horrible Bosses 2 for like 3.5 minutes.
Man, that's one of the funniest movies I've ever seen. It really is. Like, I've never gotten like bored of that movie. The jokes have never like fallen flat for me at any point. Like, I laugh every single time I watch that movie. I wish we were watching that movie.
He's like, I got it. He writes it on the board. It's like, what's that? Kidnapping. What? No, it's not.
With one more P it is. Well, whatever the fuck it, however the fuck you spell it.
I mean, are you back in your notes right now?
No, man. I pulled that one up the rip because I was watching it the other day. But now that you mention it.
No. We're not doing this again.
No, man. I'm sorry. I got to do this.
Fucking McDonald's.
There's literally a Patreon episode coming out where you guys do this. We don't need to do
That's a good teaser there, man. Patreon.com/countthedings if you want to hear me and Amin just laugh over Horrible Bosses 2 lines the whole time. How often are you having a conversation with friends, colleagues, whatever, and a subject comes up and you have to like look something up, a question really on the internet, and you're like, wow, this is really going to look bad in my browser history? It happens to me a lot. Probably on a weekly basis, probably every time I'm preparing for this very podcast. I know most of you probably thinking, why don't you just use incognito mode? Let me tell you something. Incognito mode is crap. It does not hide your activity. It doesn't matter what mode you use or how many times you clear your browser history, your internet service provider can still see every single website you've ever visited. Yeah, even that one. That's why even when I'm at home, I never go online without using ExpressVPN. It doesn't matter if you get your internet from Verizon, Comcast, AT&T, ISPs in the US can legally sell your information to ad companies. ExpressVPN is an app that reroutes your internet connection through their secure servers so your ISP can't see the sites you visit. ExpressVPN also keeps all your information secure by encrypting 100% of your data with the most powerful encryption available. Most of the time, I don't even realize I have ExpressVPN on. It runs seamlessly in the background and is so easy to use. All you have to do is tap one button, tap, tap, and you're protected. ExpressVPN is available on all your devices, phones, computers, even your smart TV, so there's no excuse for you not to be using it. Protect your online activity today with the VPN rated number one by CNET and Wired. Visit our exclusive link, expressvpn.com/dings, and you can get an extra 3 months free on a 1-year package. That's expressvpn.com/dings, expressvpn.com/dings to learn more. You want to get back to Money Plane?
Yeah, I guess so.
So the concierge offers 20-1 odds. I'm like, is that one of them will lose? Isn't that a 50-50 bet? Like, how did not every single person on this plane jump on that?
I know.
I mean, he is undefeated, though. So I mean,
yeah, it's true. He is undefeated.
Trey's never played before. This dude's undefeated.
Trey's got to go first.
Mr. McGillicuddy.
Crockett gave him an empty offer that he'd go first. Now they're arguing about who goes first. Crockett grabs the gun, says,
oh, God damn it, give me the fucking gun. I can't lose.
And then blows his brains out. Some woman gets Gallagher'd with brains all over her face.
It's okay, though. Everybody's wearing clear ponchos.
And is unaffected by it.
She's taking it to the face before, Zach.
Oh, boy. Isabella brings food to the pilot. Edge knocks him out.
Sexual tension?
Between her and the corpse?
People are into some weird things.
Isabella is complaining about her shoes, and I said, that's some good writing right there.
That is good writing, for sure. Edge didn't plan for a co-pilot after he knocks the pilot out.
How's he shocked that there's a co-pilot?
So he knocks this dude out, he goes in the cockpit backwards.
Backwards.
Before he realizes there's another guy, turns around, he says, fucking co-pilot.
And this dude's massive. This dude's got to be like 6'6".
Speaking of 6'6", he's got a strong Manu going on in the back of his hair.
He does. He really does.
I mean, that shit was shining.
They're fighting in the cockpit awkwardly. The plane starts tilting. Edge is beating up the co-pilot. This movie's half over and it's flying by.
I really did enjoy
Money Plane.
How
flying by.
No, I know. I was trying to just steamroll past it. That it was not a long movie.
Yeah, we know you hate that.
Isabella brings Trey an earpiece. Co-pilot's fish hooking Edge at one point.
He's not quite dead yet. I'm not quite dead.
The co-pilot is not acting his ass off because every time he gets punched, it looks like he's having a seizure.
The co-pilot, for a pilot, he's very well trained in hand-to-hand combat, considering he's fighting against someone who is...
Best pilots in the world.
Hello, he flies the fucking money plane.
That's a good point.
Andy Lawrence setting stuff up on the ground. It's not going well. The concierge kills someone for cheating with an ace up their sleeve. Leads Trey to the next event.
Wait. You're skipping ahead here.
You skipped the part where Trey is trying to find the server room and decides the best way to do this surreptitiously is to walk like a fucking cartoon character. Dun-dum, dun-dum, dun-dum. Like tiptoes, T-Rex hands, big steps, wide eyes. I said, was the watermelon and fried chicken too much for the budget?
Oh, boy.
Ah, Mr. Luck of the Irish himself.
Yes.
There's also a scene where Iggy is detangling a bunch of wires on a patch of dirt in the middle of nowhere.
Yeah, he's playing with his knife.
Oh.
By the way, how do you guys eat a banana?
Not with a knife.
Yeah, you don't open a banana with a knife.
I don't peel it open with a knife, I'll tell you that.
But the other thing was that he literally unpeeled the entire banana and pulled out all the banana out of the banana peel.
No, that's crazy. You're going to get your hands all like that shit all over your hands.
God gave you the perfect kind of like shawarma. You don't have to ever get your hands dirty when you eat this thing. And yet...
You know what my favorite ABC comedy from the 90s was?
Family Matters.
Shawarma and Greg.
By ABC, do you mean Arabic Broadcast Channel?
When we were in Chicago, I actually got into a fairly heated argument about how to open a banana with, I think, Jane, Kim, and Benny, because they open it from the bottom.
Bottom?
I'd never seen that before, but they said it's like, that's the best way to do it.
No.
Look, the stem at the top is a nice, gives you nice leverage from a physics standpoint to crack it.
Yes.
And then peel down.
That's what you would think, yeah.
No, that's not, that's what I know. That's what I know.
This is not a debate.
Yes. Jane and Benny are insane.
They were furious at me and me.
Like, there is one fucking way to eat a banana.
You have a zero tolerance banana policy, Zach?
I do. I absolutely do. All right. Dude gets killed. Team adventures are about to begin.
Yeah, we hear another ding, and he goes, oh my, it's almost time for our first themed adventure on the flight. I don't know, Joey Lawrence is low-key acting his ass off right now.
He has no idea what he's betting on, but he bets 17 in 17 minutes. And it's man versus cobra.
Future Cinephobe.
We cut to a TV of a dude in a cell. That's when the Rumble calls Edge. He's checking in. He mocks him with cool code names, wants to be called the Colonel.
When he calls Kelsey Grammer, he's listening to the most trap hip-hop music ever. Was he listening to Pop Smoke? I don't know. But it was not congruent with Kelsey Grammer until you remember that Kelsey Grammer was the executive producer of such shows like Girlfriends. Kelsey Grammer actually executive produced a shit ton of black TV shows. Don't ask me why.
I want my damn money, Jack!
He wants a camera with a live feed set up. The tiniest little spy camera is placed on the dash.
Cheer up! You look pissed. Ha!
And then the guy dies from the cobra in 16 minutes. McGillicuddy wins again.
Where was the snake? Because you never, I looked hard. I didn't see no snake on the screen. And then at one point, the snake hisses. They literally could not even go on YouTube to just like download snake hiss.
No, it was someone going hiss.
It was not someone. It was Andrew Lawrence. Get in the booth and just go hiss, 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 hiss. Like, it was so bad.
Now they're watching two dudes sitting at a table. One of them murders the other with a sledgehammer. Split win between McGillicuddy and the woman.
Yeah, so I think she's counting up to 200 grand, and then there's like a buzzer, and one guy raises his hand, and the other guy chops it off with an axe. And Mia Yamada says, when I was young, I chopped off arms for free.
Sexual tension.
Exposition.
Edge hears Trey puke, tells him to pull it together and go hack the server. Andy Lawrence sets up the gear on the ground with some kind of satellite type thing.
It looks like an erector set.
Now they're betting on a guy being eaten by piranhas in the water. McGee wins with a strip to the bone in 1 minute 50 seconds.
How did he have time to bet he was puking?
Did you guys see the corpse?
Yes.
Did you pause? If you haven't watched the movie yet, I want you to, when this scene comes on, just pause and take a look at what is clearly just a very rudimentary dummy. It reminded me of the Family Guy where Peter was jealous that Joe was getting all these accolades. So he decided to try and sell his own life story to the network because Joe like won in the Paralympics or something. So Peter tried to sell his life story to the networks, and he did it by faking him getting hit by a car. But when they slow down the video, he's driving the car, and the thing he hit was literally just a straw man wearing Peter's shirt and pants and glasses. And that's exactly what the corpse looked like.
Well, this is the point where Andy Lawrence eats a banana with a knife.
Then we get a little Iggy's Bored montage, and he says, this job sucks.
I don't know if they're filming his scene or if it's just a candid shot of him directing Money Plane where he says that.
Yeah, this is the writer and director of the movie.
Isabella gets caught by a guard in the hull of the plane. She says to block communication, so Edge starts playing music over the PA.
This is like a homeless version of the Rolling Stones.
And my man, holy shit, loves this song.
Loves it.
But as soon as that shit comes on, he starts bopping his head like, yeah, go ahead.
Isabella tries to seduce the guard. She starts dancing on some cargo straps, then stabs him with a heel.
Why does this always happen in action movies? When does this ever happen when a girl that you caught doing something wrong throws you the pussy and you actually catch it?
She threw her heel and it got stuck in his arm. That's what happened.
That really hurt. I'm gonna have a lump there, you idiot. Who throws a shoe? Honestly.
And then she rips his ears off.
Yes, he starts beating the shit out of her and manhandling her, and then she rips his ears off and knocks him out.
She ripped his ears off.
Both of them.
Yes, at the same time.
Suck on that, Mike Tyson.
The safe is different than what their intel said. Bite
on that, Mike Tyson? chew on that, Mike Tyson?
She's
suck
gonna,
on that. Like, it's just a little.
Oh, boy. She's going to need more time, but then uses the guard's bracelet to unlock the safe. Jackpot.
I need more time. Wait, never mind. Psych.
I like that. They sped that shit up. I appreciate that.
Yeah. Shout out to Andrew Lawrence.
She's going to need help packing it up. Trace tries to sneak away, and the women want him to do shots. And then I wrote, seriously, the star's role in this movie is to just sit there while everyone else does the action.
Yeah, he's just sitting in the cockpit making repeated phone calls, and it reminds me of Spence in the fifth season of Ballers, especially because they're both jacked wrestlers in suits.
Spence in his best.
What's the end game, Spence?
You made Levitar sound too cool there. What's the end game, Spence?
What's the end game, Spence?
Ziggy-zag, what is the end game, Spence?
May I just cut in the scene for Ballers when I do my impression? Thomas Jane calls about the botched museum job. Apparently the Rumble owns the company that owns the museum.
Why would he have you steal a painting he already owns? There's more.
The painting was transferred out of the museum the night before the heist. The museum was tipped. That sounds like a setup to me.
Edge explains the museum was a setup to everybody else. Stay alert and stay alive. They moved the duffel bag roughly 3 feet and now they're ready to go back up.
Yeah.
It was like, hey, we gotta move this stuff. And then they just put it against the wall.
Like, oh, we should go back and make another appearance. People will get suspicious, right? Like, you never go back. We never see them go back.
That's when Fat Baker Mayfield sees them exit together. The Rumble is torturing a guy and he yells, don't you piss! Don't you piss yourself!
Acting his ass off.
Of course he is!
Right then, I said, golden dumpster.
I was just happy to see him again, honestly.
Yeah.
At the point where the Edge calls him, he answers the phone, but then he looks back at the dude, very annoyed, and I was like, yo.
Yo, he shushes him.
He shushes him, but then he's still staring at him while he's trying to listen to the call from Jack or whatever.
Edge updates him on the job, then mentions the museum job. Rumble says they're looking into it still. Props henchman then shoots the guy, and Kelsey's mad.
You fucked up my terracotta. This stuff is porous. Don't you get that? For God's sake, it's bitch. It's never going to come out. It's going to stain.
I love this.
They ripped this all off from American Gangsters.
Send his ass home. Hey. Oh, don't rub on that. You block that. You understand? That's alpaca. That's $25,000 alpaca. You block that shit. Right. You don't rub on. Put the club soda on there.
Thomas Jane is playing video games with the daughter, and he's reminded of something that happened in Brazil, which never comes back.
Remember Brazil? This is just like I Am Wrath.
What happened to Brazil?
We don't know.
That's what she said. Literally.
Arms dealer and Fat Baker stalk Trey into the secret area with the server. He's hacking the server, transfers in progress. Isabella tells them to go back upstairs, but Fat Baker's gonna fight her. Arms dealer walks into the server room. He says, who stole the cookie from the cookie jar?
Trey says, who, me? And my man says, yeah, you. And Trey doesn't do the couldn't be. It's such an obvious setup. Why wouldn't you go all the way through with it?
Here's why. Because you had to cut to the next shot, which is, and I cannot stress this enough, that you guys should put this movie on and get to the point where Fat Baker Mayfield is trying to throw punches. It is the most unnatural motion I've ever seen.
I don't know if he says something or if it's just this action. But at this juncture, I decided, holy shit, just one golden dumpster. Sorry, Kelsey.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow.
Flip-flopper.
Just snatched that crown off his head.
He chokes her. She says she likes it.
He likes it.
She moves his hand down to her tit for like a good 3 seconds while he squeezes it, and then she breaks his thumb.
I would love side-by-side clips of Henry Cavill in Mission Impossible, where he cocks the arms, right?
Was it Rogue Nation or?
Oh, it was Rogue Nation. It was the latest one. Because Fat Baker Mayfield kind of does something similar, but it looks a whole lot different. I would love a side-by-side of those two things right there.
I'll take care of the guy. And he says, with pleasure. You really want to do this? Okay then, bitch. Here comes daddy. That's the line. That's the line right there. Here comes daddy. As he rolls up his sleeves in the Henry Cavill in Rogue Nation style.
She breaks bottles on him, then stabs the shit out of him with the bottles. Meanwhile, the arms dealer is fucking up Trey. He throws him into a server, and a CD-ROM tray popped out, and I just started laughing.
Party like it's 1999.
20th century, bitch.
Yeah, for real. That is a 20th century bitch moment.
He's about to kick the arms dealer into the server and electrocutes him for some reason.
Yeah, this was weak as fuck.
He did not act his ass off in this.
Can you even be electrocuted like that?
No!
Thanks, guys.
I could stick my dick in a server. It's not going to be electrocuted. It's going to get me free apps at Applebee's. All right, someone is shooting me.
Gonna say clip it, then I realized it's an original.
All right, someone's shooting at Andy Lawrence now. Two guys capture him.
There's like seven thugs at him.
Who are these peoples who so unsurely wield firearms?
They've been set up by the rumble, man.
The first dude is holding a rifle. He looks like he could shoot. Everybody else is holding a gun kind of like from the top. They look like they've never held a gun in their life. Water pistol, nothing.
Including Edge. When he first gets tossed the gun outside of the dentist's office, he looks like he's holding a stapler.
Exactly, yeah.
The transfer is messed up. Now they're going to have to download the transfer in a different way.
Why?
It's okay, because they have a plan B, I mean.
They know it's a setup. Why don't they just take the cash and the drugs and run?
Edge mentions plan B, and I wrote, ah, like the opening.
Get it?
Thomas Jane just shot one of the guys captured Andy Lawrence with a drone holding a gun.
What the fuck, guys?
It's like that. Have you guys ever seen that video of a crab holding a knife?
Yes, that's exactly what it's like.
That's what it looks like. Also, I don't know if you guys noticed when Andy Lawrence gets into the firefight, but the muzzle flashes are so fake.
Oh my God, they're so bad.
I swear, if you pause it, it'll say bang on them.
They're going to do a little shootout. Andy shoots two of the guys. Thomas Jane takes out the other four guys with the drone that has a gun taped to it.
At one point, he punches through a pile of rocks and shoots the guy. Like, he's like, oh, look, I can just punch through it. And it's like 15 feet that he punches through.
Right.
And when the drone is just wobbling around this gun, dude. And then just caps four people in the head, they don't move.
Because what it did was...
They don't shoot back.
It targeted like he was Iron Man.
Yeah, exactly. Like this is no regular drone.
And then you look at the drone and it's like not meant to hold a gun.
Have you ever like handled a drone before? You know how much expertise you would have in order to pull that off with a gun taped to it?
You know what Thomas Jane did in Brazil? Nigga, you think flying a drone is hard?
All right. The Rumble calls Edge again. Edge puts him on hold with elevator music.
Need I remind you who you work for?
I've been up here above the clouds. I don't know, it's given me some perspective. I've been thinking. What if I don't work for you? What if you were actually just a little bitch? And what if this money wasn't actually yours anymore?
Are you really fucking with me right now? Are you fucking with me?
You think you're badass, yeah? The criminals on this plane would eat you alive. On this plane, you're a dime a dozen, Colonel.
How would Edge know about the criminals on the plane? He's been in the goddamn cockpit the whole time. He talked to an arms dealer for 2 minutes.
For real? They really made my man Trey do all the fucking work.
Yes, Trey and Isabella are the heroes of the movie.
Trey's the only one who's risking his fucking life in every scene.
Mr. McGillicuddy.
This feels like a Two Americas thing.
You damn right it is.
I don't give a fuck who's on that plane. I'm the baddest motherfucker on the planet. I am Darius Grouch III, the Rumble, and I am taking down the money plane. Now bring me my money.
Woo-wee. I just wrote, says his name again, says money plane again.
And that right there, ladies and gentlemen, in a rare double reversal.
No.
The golden dumpster goes back to Kelsey Grammer. He said, your character is dead. And that's when I saved my best fucking line. He delivered that shit with so much fucking class and poise. I believe that shit. That's not Kelsey Grammer anymore. That's Oscar the Grouch III.
Sure. Oscar the Grouch III.
I was born in a fucking trash can.
Edge puts it back on hold. Rumble says, time to burn down the village. Then Thomas Jane's cooking pasta?
Yeah, why not?
Why not?
Bad guys are converging on the house. They weakly try to copy some John Wick action in the house. Jane takes them all out.
This dumb fucking assault team just shines their bright flashlights in the window.
Yeah.
There's a part where there's someone shooting at him with a rifle, and he's kind of hiding behind like a wall, or, you know, kind of a doorway or whatever.
No. It's not that. It's not a wall. It's like literally a cabinet door.
Right. And so when he pops out to shoot the dude after like the fire pauses, I'm thinking he's going to pop out, pop. Like, this motherfucker popped out and then fucking aims like he's shooting at the fucking target range. I mean, like, takes his time. And I'm like, what are you doing, asshole? He's standing still. The gun's not even aimed.
My next note, Thomas Jane wears the hell out of a vest.
Better or worse than The Rock?
Oh, no. The Rock. The Rock's going to take that home.
I don't think anyone wears a vest as good as The Rock. Other than short Italian security managers at Vegas nightclubs.
That's true.
Bearded and with the gel in their hair.
Donald Pizan.
Yeah, them motherfuckers, you win. You take the cake at wearing vests. Vest and a shirt and a tie, but no jacket. Little earpiece, y'all motherfuckers win, man. But number two on that list is The Rock, and number three is Thomas Jane in the scene.
Edge gets off his ass and joins the team in the hall.
Yeah, he finally engages autopilot.
He could have just been doing that the whole time.
I guess he had to fly it into range to get the erector set satellite transfer or whatever, but it seems to me like he could have autopiloted.
Shout out to the concierge who never once checked to see if everything was okay when this plane was barrel rolling and doing all types of wild ass shit.
They're going to donate the money to UNICEF, refugees in Syria, whomever.
Like Robin Hood, you guys.
Oh, like the book.
They're coming up with this plan on the fucking fly, right there, right on the spot. They're coming up with this plan.
Also, he can just do it from his phone, which is chill. In a couple of seconds.
They're putting on backpacks that I think we're supposed to believe are parachutes.
No, they're going backpacking through Europe.
None of them want the cash?
Edge calls the rumble. He repeats the every job has three critical parts speech.
Except he adds, you need a proper diversion to number two. That wasn't there before.
That wasn't part of the original.
Tells the rumble about giving the money away. The rumble threatens him. Now Edge plays for the entire money plane when the rumble said he doesn't care who's on that plane. He's taking it down.
I want to point out right now that the Skype connection that they are using,
fucking stunning,
is so flawless for plain kind of satellite. I don't know if you've ever used GoGo on air.
Oh, it's awful.
Look, I'm sitting right here in my Death Star studio with a dedicated hardwire line. There is no other device other than the TV I just turned on right now to queue up to Money Plane and find that little scene that is using internet in this house. And even then, my internet connection on this call is fucking iffy. And these motherfuckers are using video and audio while one motherfucker is on a plane in international waters.
Airspace.
And that shit is 4K. Unbelievable.
It's incredible. Concierge tells the bad guys that the Rumble's head will be on a platter by the time they land. The house will cover any lost funds. New wager on when they get notice of the Rumble's death.
That's a good insurance policy they got on the money plane.
It is. It's actually a pretty good business if you think about it. Like, there, it's really well done. Yeah.
House never loses. Always remember that, guys.
Last job to do will be getting the painting.
Yeah, we get this fantastic celebratory dialogue here. We just did that. First time for everything. We never did get that painting. Well, I guess we have one last job to do. Payback's a bitch.
And then he kicks open the plane door.
This is not how physics works.
This is my favorite part of this movie.
Money flies out the door and they're pretending to struggle with getting sucked out of the plane.
They like turned on a small fan.
I mean, do you wanna describe how they jump out of the plane?
Whatever set they had built was approximately 5 to 7 inches off the floor. Because these guys are pretending they're jumping out of a plane, but instead they just kind of hop gingerly forward. Apparently they couldn't afford a mattress either.
Sometimes they're struggling to walk, but other times they're just walking normally.
I think there's a point where they realize, oh shit, we're going to have to jump out of this plane at some point. How do we pull this off from a visual standpoint? And they're like, what if it became nighttime?
Yeah. Just make it pitch black outside.
They jump into pitch black outside.
They hop gingerly. They don't jump.
I'm sorry.
That is the jump of someone who knows ground is right there.
When you were a kid and you were trying to avoid stepping on a crack on the sidewalk, you jumped higher than they did getting out of this plane.
Yes. With a lot more believability.
Yes.
A lot more suspension of disbelief. as a child, jumping over a crack in the sidewalk.
At one point, Trey throws a shrink-wrapped wad of the dollar bills out the plane door, and that's a deadly weapon, guys. That could kill someone.
Good. Oh, all right.
The also, rubble. Trey, you risk more than anybody on this mission. The fuck, I'm not going to take some of this money.
Exactly. How do none of them want money?
It's insane. The Rumble finds some kind of device under his table that Edge apparently put there. We get a flashback.
That reminded me of the I Am Wrath scene where the daughter gives him the gun. Yes. And they flash back to it, and it's like, clearly wasn't there the first time, but in the flashback, oh, we see God. It.
I missed that movie. The props henchman wants out, and the Rumble shoots him.
Hold on. You said the props henchman, like, that motherfucker doesn't have a name, Zach.
Yeah, what's his name, I mean?
P-Roach.
Cut my life into pieces. This is my last resort. Suffocation. No breathing. Don't give a fuck if I cut my arm bleeding.
This is my last resort. So the question I had, Maze, because I didn't know, is that dude actually in the band Papa Roach? Because I don't know what they look like, but I was like, maybe.
It's a late life renaissance for him. He's, you know, he switched disciplines, but he's just an artist.
Is Papa Roach an artist or a band?
It's a band.
The Rumble shoots him and grabs a machine gun. And then my next note, is this team of killers rolling up in a minivan?
They are, and they are quite quick with the reaction. Like, did they just have a wet team everywhere in the world?
They've got, I mean, it's the money plane, I mean.
But, I mean, just that feel like they kind of tracked it down really quickly.
And then we get a shot of Kelsey Grammer firing this machine gun off into the distance and just screaming, a primal scream. And I wrote, the movie ends with Rumble firing a machine gun and screaming?
He also whispers,
Rumble time.
Rumble time.
The note I have written, I think it sounds like this, but I can't remember. Yeah!
Was it the Howard Dean?
Yeah! Yeah!
We're going to Michigan.
Yeah!
And then my next note, damn it, no. We get a 3 months later in Istanbul.
Why wrote not there? Constantinople.
No, it's not.
If it's Istanbul, then it's Constantinople.
Istanbul, Constantinople. All right.
You sound like Joey Lawrence saying concierge.
He's trying to say Constantinople. A crate is opened and a canvas with a stick figure given the middle finger is pulled out.
Art.
That is a dope fucking situation. You know why? Because for a moment I was like, they did all that shit for that piece of shit painting? Then I was like, wait a second. No, I mean, I think this might be a switcheroo.
Do you think that was the same white canvas that the props henchman had? That P. Roach had?
Absolutely.
Wait, does P. Roach stand for props, Roach?
You like that, Maze?
I'll give you your props for that, Zach.
Maze, you thought that one was funny?
You didn't like that?
Nah.
Oh, fuck you, man. Oh, my God. Now Edge is in the backyard. Thomas Jane calls him, smoking a pipe once again with an offer on the painting. It's now worth $60 million.
Split four ways ain't bad, and Edge says five ways. Sevier and Paris.
I got some fucking problems with this, okay? My note is, no. You can take that from your cut. I want my $15 million.
For real.
You want to be generous, go ahead. You split your 15 with him.
Especially if I'm Trey. Y'all made me fucking play fucking Russian roulette. Also, we never mentioned this, but when we're watching all these people die horrible deaths in the experience entertainment room or whatever, the lady who is calling out the bets is positively orgasming at every opportunity at the way these people are dying, which made me think, yo, you're just an employee. Like, who the fuck are you to be getting off on this shit with your $12 an hour ass? Fucking the nerve of these hoes.
We end with the family playing with the dog. Still no chemistry amongst them.
Why is the painting outside?
Yeah, it's a $60 million painting. It's just sitting next to firewood, you know?
Why are you putting it outside in the elements, you stupid fucking uncultured fuck?
Credits.
Not much trivia here. I only have a couple of things.
My favorite trivia, though, despite popular belief, this movie has no connection to Money Train.
Despite popular belief.
That's in great. The trivia question on IMDb.
Tom Arnold was originally cast as the cowboy. Tom Berenger was also considered for the role, and it ended up with Matthew Lawrence.
And Tom Arnold was a cowboy in Austin Powers.
Tom Arnold would have been perfect.
He'd been great.
Because it was kind of a little bit of a silly character.
Inspired by heist movies such as Ocean's 11, airplane movies such as Con Air, and their experiences in Las Vegas, producer Switzer and Connie turned to Andrew Lawrence. Lawrence proposed an airplane casino movie, which Switzer and Connie agreed to fund after Lawrence wrote a screenplay.
No, none of that is true.
After plans to film in Romania and Toronto proved unworkable, the production moved to Baton Rouge, Louisiana.
I was hoping you were going to say Alhambra, California. I was like, oh, shit.
Bullshit. They were in Palmdale.
The project's low budget and rushed schedule frequently required Lawrence to improvise and to adjust shooting based on which sets were available.
No shit.
We were literally building the plane set while we were shooting. We picked corners of the set that were built and shot in those corners. We had to do that all the time. And the majority of the remaining trivia is from Ringer's Money Plane Oral History by Alan Siegel on July 14th, 2020.
Let me just say right now, that movie's not old enough to have an oral history. I see what you're doing, Ringer, but fuck that shit. We have to have standards. We have to have standards. We cannot do fucking oral histories for shit that just came out and is fucking awful.
It's just short of Edge looking down the barrel of a camera and winking at the audience, says first-time director Andrew Lawrence.
What?
Which we actually shot at one point, but the powers that be made me tone it down a bit.
Kelsey Grammer was their first choice for Darius Grouch, and they didn't expect him to accept the role. When he accepted, he later said the role seemed like a fun, mustache-twirling kind of character.
Shout out to Kelsey Grammer. Like, the motherfucker's a really good actor.
He's really good.
Sometimes people get washed, and they gotta take these shitty roles, and they take them, and either because they're washed, they're not good at acting anymore, or they know this is a washed role, so they don't fucking put their heart into it. And Kelsey Grammer came in here and was like, I'm going to approach this like a fucking actor. Like, this is a real script.
Yeah.
And he did that shit. Like, I really actually fucking, like, jokes aside, I respect that shit. I respect the fuck out of you, Kelsey Grammer. Be a guest on Cinephobe.
Yeah, Kelsey, come on.
Joey Lawrence. I take partial responsibility. Matt will as well, because we infused a young Andrew with Marked for Death and Hard to Kill. From the late 80s to the early 90s, we forged our way into, Time Cop, Passenger 57, no, Murder at 1600, Rising Sun.
No, you didn't. Stop naming Wesley Snipes movies. Stop blaming black people.
Interestingly, no one on the production team cites the 1995 Wesley Snipes Woody Harrelson vehicle Money Train as an influence. Tyler W. Connie, I don't think I've seen Money Train.
Fuck
Richard
you.
Switzer, I also have not seen it.
Fuck you.
I hate these guys.
Fuck both of you. You guys are movie producers? Fuck both of you, unless you're going to produce my movie, which, you know.
Andrew Lawrence, when I was writing this role that Kelsey played, it's like a Scarface wannabe, a version of this character of a crime boss. How cool would it be to have someone with a great voice, an actor with some gravitas, just kind of iconic from films and TV? And I threw out Kelsey because of his voice. I love his voice. Switzer, who doesn't love Kelsey Grammer? We went to him first and did not think that he would really do it.
Zach Harper, did you write this fucking movie?
You think that anybody but Nick Cage would have been in this movie if I wrote it?
That's a good-ass point. But Nick Cage would not have played...
The fuck he wouldn't have.
No, he would not have played Kelsey Grammer's character.
He would have played Jack.
Yeah, absolutely.
Kelsey Grammer! The film crossed my desk with an offer, and it seemed like a fun, mustache-twirling kind of character that would not change my life, certainly, but put me in the sandbox with a new actor I like, Adam Copeland, Edge. That is usually one of the things I respond to in this job. New people. I also quite like Thomas Jane, and it was nice to work with him again. No scenes together. Adam Copeland, Edge. My mom had actually passed away the year prior, and her favorite actor, bar none, was Kelsey Grammer. The first show I ever clearly remember watching with my mom is Cheers, and from there, it was Frasier. I literally feel like I grew up with the man. Connie, Thomas Jane brings his own iconography into this because he was in The Punisher. You know that Thomas carries with him subtle mannerisms and a certain quiet tough guy thing that works really well for the role. Jane was unavailable for comment. Speaking of the budget, Connie, I can tell you it was less than 100 million. Switzer laughs. I was going to say less than 50. Connie, we're narrowing it down for you. Switzer, we made a lot of movies in the past on shoestring budgets and have learned over the years how to stretch a dollar.
No, you haven't.
Pulled all the favors we had on this one and just figured out a way to get it done.
No, you didn't.
Switzer, once we found this plane in Louisiana, we decided to go there. So we got to take this plane, completely refurbish it, and then build a casino on it. That was a poker table.
No, you didn't.
And a craps table that never got used. Andrew Lawrence, talk about building a plane during flight. We were literally building the plane set while we were shooting. It was insane. Matthew Lawrence, it's a Jaws equation when you can't show a shark because you don't have a whole shark. Yeah, you guys made Jaws.
Just like it.
Money Plane. Andrew Lawrence. We picked corners of the set that were built and shot in those corners. We had to do that all the time. Switzer. My favorite part of shooting was actually, this is in the trailer, when Kelsey grabs his assault rifle and gets ready for the guys that are coming for him. We start rolling. He grabs a gun. And I remember just thinking, Fraser Crane is now Scarface.
Yeah.
Can't believe we did this. Andrew Lawrence. There's this one cockpit fight we filmed for 8 hours. Edge did it all himself. Connie, he went up against a stuntman who was really a pro. Edge, what was difficult about that is the guy I was fighting was 6'6", and I'm 6'4", and we're in a cockpit trying to do this. And finally, Andrew Lawrence, I do love sequels, Matthew Lawrence, or a prequel, on a boat, call it Money Boat. Joey Lawrence, Money Sub, Money Copter. They didn't have the money for a full plane, so they just had to use a little helicopter.
I'm starting to figure out how the Lawrence brothers never really fully sustained a career. I'm sure they have money at this point from residuals and all that shit, but these guys suck. All right, let's get to the golden dumpsters.
Yeah. Well, I mainly eat out of a dumpster.
I should try that. I need some new dresses.
Don't. Or if you do, stay away from the one in Ocean and Wilshire. That's mine. Seriously. Stay out of it.
Golden Dumpster nominees. I mean, already flip-flopped twice, but Kelsey Grammer is Darius Emmanuel Grouch the Third, better known as the Rumble. Crockett shouting, I can't lose, before he blows his brains out. Iggy using a knife to open a banana. Thomas Jane using a drone to shoot people instead of going there himself and doing some actual work. And Reed, a.k.a. Fat Baker Mayfield, fighting Isabella.
I mean, you gave it to Kelsey?
Rumble time.
Yeah!
I'm going to give it to Fat Baker Mayfield.
Oh, holy shit gets his fucking... Yeah. I feel bad for holy shit. I feel like if he was staying alive a little longer, he could have won it back. I mean, it was that kind of... It was literally one of those...
He needed one more scene.
It was just whoever has the ball last is going to win this series.
Yep. Absolutely.
I got to agree with Amin. It's Kelsey Grammer. Between the opening monologue, the alligator fucking line.
Oh, man. Actually,
the shooting of the machine gun.
Are we going to sweep it? Should I change and sweep it?
You should sweep it. We haven't sweeped it in a while.
Yeah, let's sweep it.
It's got to be. Sorry, Kelsey. Holy shit.
Yeah.
That was the last one that we had, last sweep we had.
Jason Sudeikis as Bat Douche.
Oh, yeah.
iconic movie 43.
All right. Did I pick this?
You did, sir.
I picked it, motherfucker.
Didn't you?
All right, phobe or file? This is a tough one because I really appreciate Kelsey Grammer. I really do. The rest of this movie is just awful. It is up there with one of the worst movies we've ever done. But I think Kelsey saved it. I'm going to file this thing. And if it's almost anybody else other than Kelsey Grammer.
I'm fucking so. Because Zach actually pretended to have an existential crisis about whether he was going to phobe or file one of his own picks.
No, I legitimately flopped back and forth during this movie. If it had ended on Kelsey Grammer shooting that gun and just screaming into the ether, it would have been an easy file. But it was a tough one. Yeah, I'll file it.
I'm not going to hold you guys in suspense here. That's a phobe.
What?
Oh, well, that movie was terrible. Oh, I never want to watch it again. It has none of the appeal of many of the other kind of really bad action movies that we've done. And I'm like, you know what? I could rewatch it. This movie, other than Kelsey Grammer and my man, holy shit. No, this is a strong phobe for me.
Wow.
Wow.
We are definitely in it's so bad, it's good territory for a good chunk of this movie. But somehow, it made 82 minutes seem like an eternity.
No way. That shit flew by, man. No way.
I phobed it, but I'll stick up for it. It did not drag.
Look, man, when we cut back to Edge for the 9th time and he's sitting in the cockpit making a phone call, I'm like, what are we doing?
You're going to make me pissed, man.
The fuck are we doing is my question. You cast a wrestler to sit there and not fight, apparently.
Man, if we keep dragging this episode out, you know, we have to tell Amin you're in trouble.
Don't pee. Hey, don't you dare pee. Don't you dare pee.
Don't you piss.
You're not going to file that? You kidding me? I'm going to watch a man fuck an alligator. Money plane. He doesn't even say it's going to be, you're going to find that on the money plane. It's just two words after that prompt. Money plane.
Kelsey Grammer knocks it out of the park. There's definitely a lot of enjoyable stuff. After this marathon podcast, I have swung all the way back to a file.
Wow. Fuck off, Amin.
Wow. Fuck both of you guys. You're fucking awful. Fucking tasted movies. Also, if you want to see a podcaster piss all over his brand new leather couch, money plane.
Next time we make love, you introduce me to Jade.
Next pick.
Maze.
All right, so it's my pick, you guys, and I mean, you know, we just did Money Plane, Zach. It's all right. Oh, fuck that up. Yeah. All right, it's my pick. We just did Money Plane. I mean, you chose Money Train. You guys really backed me into a corner here. I want to pick Money Automobiles, but it does not exist
yet
until the Lawrence brothers get their hands on another
stimulus check.
Or Wesley and Woody.
That's true. That's true.
And so it is with much joy that I take us down into the depths again. This is a movie that has been on my list since the early days of Cinephobe.
Hurry up, I gotta piss.
Finally, it popped up on HBO Max. And now it's time for Troll 2.
What?
What? Troll 2.
Buckle up, motherfuckers.
Wait, hold on. Is that the one with fucking Justin Timberlake and Anna Kendrick?
No, it is not Trolls World Tour. It is quite different, actually.